Okay. Don, you may have known this already, but this was an overlay laying on top of a Voyager faceplate, but I know the Voyagers are all gray, so looks like somebody ordered the chrome bezel for it and then picked this Voyager silver faceplate and put on a chrome bezel, because the Voyager VR9000 is, you know, the bezel's gray, the faceplate's gray, and most of the lettering is yellow. So anyway, I thought I were to show you that. Your bezel's not in too bad a shape. It's got quite a few scratches on it, but it should clean up nice, and when I put the decal on it, you won't be able to see the Voyager through it. I could see the word Voyager and VR9000 through the through this thing. It's still in pretty good shape. I'll save it for you and send it back to you. Somebody put silicone on everything. The cases were slippery and they don't fit right. Of course, you probably know that. Well, I ain't gonna put the damn things back on here after I get through with it, so you're gonna have to buy a set of covers. I got some covers that fit like they're supposed to. Gotta get these. And why did they put this lens on there? That, see how it refracts everything? It's not clear, it's opaque. So that's gotta go. Of course, the yellow one I had to go and be replaced with green. But anyway, just wanted to show you that. I've got the radio started the disassembly. Got to take all that stuff out and figure out what the hell they were doing right there. But a lot of work. Okay, more to come. Okay, Don, I couldn't stand getting that silicone shit all over my hands anytime I was working in here, and I always wound up with that crap all over my fingers, and as well as the dirt off the radio. So I broke out my super secret cleaning solution. I cleaned the shit out of this thing. Look at that. Looks like a brand new one. Both inside and out. I got the front panel. Cleaned all of it. Got all that crap out of the wires. Doesn't that look nice? Switch panel and all that stuff got clean. I've got your green displays mounted in the switchboard, the display switchboard. All right, and let's see, I've got your adapter mounted on the channel selector. Okay, continuing on, more to come. Okay, Don, I just ran into another problem. Your radio has an 8719-A, RCI 8719-A. Okay. What this means, and I found this out by just going ahead and trying to do the mod. It doesn't have a tri-state function, basically. What that means is that it only has 128 channels in it. So the highest the radio will go with that chip in it is channel 108, 28083. You can't get to 10 meters with it. And the lowest it'll go is 26. 085. I'm sorry, 26815. Now, there's something wrong with the clarifier circuit too, because if I turn the clarifier circuit up to where this is on a 5, see what happens? There's something in the clarifier circuit that's screwed up. I got to go in and find out what the hell is wrong with that. But what I've been doing is keeping it turned all the way counterclockwise, so it don't screw me up. That's your lowest frequency. And then when you go to what should be 28725, it goes down one more channel to 26802. And then it does all kind of weird stuff. It keeps going down, okay? Well, then until the clarifier unlocks. Go back up here. All right, 26877978. And right there, the clarifier starts to unlock. Now, if I keep tweaking the VCO, I can get it to go on down. See, it continues to go right on down, okay? See just how far down it will go. Right there, it stopped. We tweaked the VCO again. Clarifier is trying to mess up. It's getting too low for it to work now. I was trying to get it go down far enough to where that. Oh, sorry about that. I turned that down. Trying to get it to go down far enough that we could see just how it worked. It ain't gonna do no more. It's trying to skew the VCO the wrong way too much. Okay. 28619. It just come unlocked. Alright, there we are. Back on 108.28.082. So we get back up to 26,440, 445, 454. See, it starts working again. So that might be handy for getting down to 26,512, but the display don't match. I'm wondering if, well. Now, I'm just going to go ahead and replace the PLL, okay? You didn't tell me in your notes here if you wanted high range or low range. At least I don't think you did. No, so I'll need to shoot you an email and find out what you want to do with that. Let's see if you told me on this part. Nope. All right. Well, that's where I'm at. I'm going to go shoot you a quick email, and then I'm going to be stopped at that point until I hear back from you. I need to fix a couple of these damn inductors. That may be what's wrong. Right now I've got it set up for high range. But it's no problem to change it to low range if you prefer low range. But I'm going to set it aside until I hear back from you. All right. More to come. Okay. Got this. PLL chip changed out. I don't have the CSL switch hooked up yet. You can see now though, it goes right on up. There's 771, 72, and it should roll back over to 26,815, which it did. Every now and then, it'll miss a beat, and that's your channel selector. I sprayed some cleaner down in it, so it works pretty good, but you'll see every now and then it'll do the same channel twice. It works better if you turn it slow. Either turn it slow or turn it fast. Okay, don't. This speed right here is where it messes up at. But, you know, it may get better the more you use it. But it's definitely in the channel selector there. Okay. Right down on 38. Now I got to take this panel back out and wire these switches up like they're supposed to be. It's going to be your amp control. This is going to be CSF. Noise blanker will be on the top, A&L on the bottom. And this is squelch scan up, squelch scan down. Okay? That's the way they're going to be. And also I need to put the resistor in the line for that to dim it down some. It's much brighter than what the old one were. The old ones were. And I need to get it dimmed down to where it's about the same brightness as the channel selector. Because right now it's too bright. I mean, that'll light up a room. All right. More to come. I've got the CSF switch hooked up. Now with that switch pushed in, your channel selector becomes your band switch. You see, it'll change it 45 channels at a time. Okay, that's your lowest channel. That's your highest channel. Okay. And with the CSF out, it changes one channel at a time. Alright, that's noise blanker and A&L. Got both of those on now. Alright. I wanted to show you the clarifier. I don't have the 10 turn installed yet. I just finished the clarifier modification. Okay, that's down. And that's up. Okay. Once I get the 10 turn in there, it'll be a little easier to handle. Alright, I don't have the squelch hooked up yet for the squelch scan, but I've got scan wires hooked up. And of course, without a squelch signal, it's just going to sit there. But that scan up, that scan down. Okay, and remember, if you have the CSF switch turned on, it won't scan. Okay. All right, more to come. Okay, done. One other thing that I'm going to have to take care of is. Watch what happens when I push in the power cord. Now, I've taken these pins out once already, and they got little keeper keys on them. Let me turn down this radio here. They got little keeper keys on them that are supposed to keep them from backing out. Okay, I've already took the pins all the way out, spread those keeper keys out, stuck them back in there until they snapped, and the first time I pushed the power cable back in there, the damn pins came back out. It's just not holding. I guess there's no ridge or whatever on the inside of this damn connector to hold them in place. And this looks like the original connector. See, I can push them back in there with my hand, but you know, the radio is going to be closed up and you're going to be trying to put your power cable in there, and the down pins are going to come out the back and you're not going to be making connection. So, of course, we are adding an RFX150 on here. Alright, what I might do is just disconnect this one and use the power cable for the RFX150. Yeah, I guess that's what I'll do. Just put some heavy duty coils in here, disconnect it from these pins, and I'm going to replace it. I don't like leaving shit like that, so I'm going to replace it with a, it'll be the new Ranger. It won't have the little metal clips on it. It'll be the black one that's got the tabs made out of plastic on the outside of it. They're good thick plastic. They're pretty good connectors. I wish I could get a bunch of the old white Uniden connectors. That's what these are trying to emulate, but they're just, it's not that great. Okay. This is what I did. To start with, I replaced that protection diode down there with a 10 amp protection diode. Okay, this one right here. Also added a 6 amp onto the back of this one, so you got 16 amps of protection. Now, what I do on these, that's the leads of that big diode, okay? It's coming out and going straight over to where that inductor connects to the board. Okay, same thing with the positive side. All right. And I put much heavier duty inductors in there. You can see here I use the FW Miller inductors. Put them in here. They carry a lot more current. There's the old ones. Little bitty thin things. These are the ones you usually find that are turned brown. Somebody talks on the AM a lot. They get real hot. And they can actually short out, and once they short out, they ain't doing you no good at all. But got these two big heavy duty Miller inductors on there to filter that out. I had to bend the leads back down a little bit to get to the pins, but you can see the pins they don't move when you pull this out. If I can get it out, it's a tight fit. It's kind of hard to do with one hand. There it is, pulled it out, and then when I put it back in, they don't move, okay? Oh, that's what it looks like on the outside. These are Galaxy power connectors. Can't find the Unitons anymore. I found some, I think Workman makes some cheap knockoffs, but they are cheap. And I need to solder that thing right there. But I'll do that in just a second. But that's what I did with the power. Now, when I put the amp in here, I'll run power cables over here to these. Okay, so that when you got the power connected to the amplifier connector, it also powers the radio. But that means, though, that the pins in this connector will also be hot. I'll explain that more when we get the amplifier put in. I'm just about ready to start on that. I've got all the diode upgrades done. There's those two, MC, what is it, 301, 302. There's the, what is that, D21, 22 up underneath there, and then I also did the noise blanker diodes, the D1, D2 over here. Okay. Got the RF amps upgraded, did the broadband on the receive and the transmit. And I've already showed you the clarifier, so And I'll have all these wires all dressed and all neat. So I'll be starting on the RFX150 here shortly. Okay, more to come. While I was tuning up the receiver, I noticed your noise blanker wasn't working. That is R6 right there and TR8 right next to it, both part of the noise blanker circuit. I was going to start doing the improvements to the noise blanker, and before I did, I thought I would check. Let's see if I can get it on the scope. I bet you wondered why your noise blanker wasn't doing anything. R6, one end of it had already come out of the board. When I touched it, it fell all the way out. Let's see. There's the spikes from the noise blanker right there. It's on my 2246 scope. Okay. That's with the noise blanker on. And you hear the radio's quiet. Let me turn the noise blanker off. I got nothing. Turn it back on. What'd that do? Oh. Might help if I put the scope on it, huh? I need two hands. That's with the noise blanker on. Okay. That's with the noise blanker off. Okay. Now there's where I'm measuring at. See that? So the noise blanker works now. Okay. Like I said, that was TR-8. He's a 2SC-945. And I changed him to a 2SC-2999. Which actually boosted the noise blanker signal a little bit. And I also replaced R6 since it came out with a 22K ohm instead of another 46. So it made, as you can tell, it made drastic improvements to your noise blanker circuit. A and L. It's not doing much at all. The noise blanker knocks it out. At least it does now. It wasn't, and I couldn't figure out what the hell was going on, and then I found R6 when I got probing around in that area. Looks like someone had already tried to hook an O-scope up to it or something to figure out what was wrong with the noise blanker, but I guess maybe lack of experience or whatever, they couldn't figure it out. But there it is. Look at that. So, all right, moving on. Got the 10 turn in. Thought I'd show you the slide here. I'm on 38. May have already shown it to you. It goes up 6 and goes down 6. And there you go. center slot. Okay, now you'll get a knob that matches the rest of the knobs on the radio. I just got this one on here so I could set up the clarifier, you know, the top and bottom limits. Moving on. Okay. Show you something else. I'm getting ready to put the echo in. Look at that board right there. Just by touching the wires, it started moving. So I got down here where I could wiggle it. Look at that. It's coming out of the mic jack. I can almost pull it all the way out. Yeah, if it wasn't for that ring soldered on there with that little tab, I could pull the damn thing all the way out. See that little ring soldered right there? That's messed up. I'll have to look and see if I got another one of these. If I do, we can change it out. If I don't, I guess I could always change it to a 4-pin. Damn. The more I do, the more I find. All right. Okay, I put your radio serial number on top of the amp there, okay? I did grind off the bottom of the screws and nuts so they couldn't touch anything inside the amp, and I put Loctite on the bottom of those screws, just like I did the mounting screws where they come through the back of the radio there. Okay, and this fuse is a 10-amp fuse. The power is coming through this power jack, through the amplifier, out through the bundle, through the fuse, and into the radio power jack. So when you got power applied to, turn that radio down. When you got power applied to the amplifier, you also got power applied to the back of this power connector. So the pins are hot. Just remember that. Okay. You can't just touch them. You have to stick up in there to get to them, but they are hot. Just remember that. Okay. Okay, I unsoldered that tab ring and it just fell off. So, either going to convert it to a 4-pin or have to find another 5-pin. Alright. Okay, we're in luck. Got a brand new 5-pin. So, I'll replace this with this, and this will go in the trash. Okay, I decided to go ahead and make it a 4-pin. I did have another one of these, but I noticed your microphone that you gave me to rewire was a 4-pin, and most everybody wants 4-pins now, so I just went ahead and took that out and wired in a 4-pin. And basically what I did, this is the mic jack and circuit board out of a Ranger AM radio. I had a couple of these, one out of the parts radios. So I took one and wired it in. I'll flip it over and show it to you in just a minute. I'll be taking that out because you don't need the transistor switch on there. It's switched in the microphone. Hello, hello, hello. So, I'll okay, now where was I? Okay, I'm going to disconnect that because you don't need the transistor switch. Hello, audio. Audio, hello. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Test, test, test. That's on AM. That's on the lower sideband. Hello, lower sideband. 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. And my lower sideband is off frequency. What the hell happened? Must have bumped the knob. Hello, 1, 2, 1, 2, hello. Audio, hello, hello, 1, 2. Going into the dummy load. Audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Amplifier is on. Let's turn the amp off. Hello, that's the amplifier off. Audio, I'm on a 100 watt scale, which is on that bottom scale. Audio, hello. Yeah, little RFX is doing its thing. I don't have the fan kit put on yet. Okay. This is RFX on. Audio, hello, hello, audio. I need to put this on times two. Turn the RF gain down on that thing before I burn it up. Hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Audio, hello, hello, audio. And it don't like running through that wire because it ain't getting enough juice. I need to turn that off. Be blowing that damn fuse. Okay, that's better. Audio, hello, hello, audio. Audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And remember, that top one is on the 250 watt scale. Audio, hello, hello, audio. 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. Okay. Like I said, you now have a 4-pin mic. All right, I'll get back at it. Okay. Got the Echo installed right there. So what I did was take the mic gain and put it where the RF gain was. Okay, this is now your mic gain. I had to order another decal too. But anyway, this is now your mic gain. Okay, this is now your local DX switch. I basically moved the RF gain to a switch, okay? With the button out, I think that's right. With the button out, I'll have to double check myself again, but I think with the button out, you're in DX. With the button pushed in, you're in local. And there's the adjustment for it right there. I've got it preset about halfway. I'll check it again once I get it on an outside antenna and set it up to where that, you know, then when you push it in, only strong signals will come in. Okay. So this is your Echo mic gain local DX switch. Noise blanker and ANL are now on a single switch. Push that switch in, they're both on. Switch out, they're both off. Okay, this is still your amplifier, but it also controls the fans. All right, there's your fans. When I push that button in, fans come on. So as long as your amplifier is turned on, your fans are running. I did have it set up so that when you keyed the amplifier, they come on. And when you unkeyed, they went off. But I decided to do it the other way. Just have them come on when you turn the amplifier on and stay on until you turn it off. And that switch right there. You can see your fans are running now. Take that switch off and you'll see the fans stop. Okay. There's the grounds for the fan right in here to the ground plane, which is connected directly to the audio transformer ground. Okay. Right where the audio transformer the audio transformer itself is not connected to ground, but the loop shield that goes around it is connected to ground. And this run right here goes to the same spot I got the fans grounded, so you don't get fan noise in the receiver. Okay, there's your hot wires for the fans. They're going to this relay. See, it comes up right there. I've got 13 volts running to the relay from the power jack. Coming right in here. And there's the control wire that comes from the front panel right there. And you push the amp switch on, it puts 5 volts on that pin right there. And this pin here has ground connected to it. It's connected to the ground side of the power jack. So when you push in that switch, it activates the relay and puts this 12 volts on the fans back here. Okay? So as long as your amp's running, your fans are running. There's where your echo board is mounted. I had to do something about tying up all these wires. Boy, I tell you, the inside of this radio is full. There's your new 4-pin jack. The LC5304. And all the extra stuff I did, I put this, replaced this guy with a 5-watt transistor, power transistor. This controls the current for the transistors when you're an AM. I changed that to a 5-watt to handle more current. Did the broadband on the receiver, broadband on the transmit. Okay, what else have I done? Got your 10-turn installed. Repaired your noise blanker. Well, you heard that. No, I don't want you in scan. Come out of scan. I know what else I got to do. I got to put the white face in the meter and add. You said, looking at your sheet here, you said transmit white on green. Transmit white. Well, I don't have a white and green LED. I got blue and red, I got green and red, but I don't have green and white. So I'll have to email you about that and see what you want me to do about it. I guess I could put 2 LEDs in there, but what a pain in the ass. Anyway, if that's what you want, that's what I'll do if you're willing to pay for it. Okay. And this light right here is going to be your amplifier indicator. When you push in the amplifier button, there'll be an LED where your transmit receive LED used to be. That'll come on and tell you that the amp is on. It'll be labeled amp. Okay. And just remember, when you turn the amplifier on, your fans come on. Okay. Amp off, fans go off. All right. More to come. Okay, Don, here's the new chrome covers I was telling you about. I got to put the speaker in. I got the speaker out of your old one. I'm getting ready to put it in these new ones. I wanted to show you what they look like. There's the top one. And let's see how they wrap the bottom one up. There we go. There's the bottom one. Got the right speaker grill in it. And you can see the sides are straight, no scratches. I got to put the speaker in it, and I think that it will fit in the radio with the speaker on it, but we'll find out. If not, then I'll get you an external speaker, but I think it will. I don't think I'll have any trouble with that. All right, more to come. Now, I wanted to show you that your old cover did not have a speaker cover with it. It was just a speaker put right against the bottom cover. Nothing to keep crap out of the speaker. So, I got a brand urine right there. See, that goes against the cover, and then the speaker goes over that, and that keeps trash and crap from getting on your speaker. The cloth there catches it. It's grill cloth. I mean, you know what that is. All right, I'll punch the holes in it, get it installed. And I got the grill cloth installed, got the speaker reinstalled. I need to put some Loctite on the screw studs to keep them from backing out. There it is, and these are the same covers that I use on the 148F LTDs that I built. So they're really good covers. I'm gonna wrap it back up in this until I'm totally done with the radio. I need to do the faceplate, but just me touching them left fingerprints on them, so I don't want to do that. So I'm gonna wrap them back up in this cloth until I get ready to actually mount them on the radio. But I thought you'd like to see. It's got the grill cloth in it. Everything done. I'm about to add the Loctite to the threads and make sure those nuts don't back off. And I may try to put some kind of insulator over the bottom of it. Not sure what I'm going to use yet, but probably just a thin piece of plastic, cut a hole in the middle of it for the center part to stick through, and shield everything else. All right, Don, the speaker ain't going to fit. Push it down in the back, it raises up in the front. If I push it down in the front, it raises up in the back. And that's something that came off my gloves. I touched that damn heat sink compound. Damn it. Got that on my gloves. And I got that on your chrome cover. Take some Windex and get it off. Damn it, that's why I put on these fucking gloves, so we get fingerprints on there. Anyway, gonna take the speaker out. I'll send you an external speaker to go with it, but it's just too much shit inside the radio. It ain't gonna fit like that. I might could try turning the kit, but if I turn the kit, I still wouldn't have enough room. All right, I'll pull it out, send you an external speaker. Okay, there she is, all lit up. The flickering for the 3-digit display is because of the refresh rate of the radio display syncing with the frame rate of the camera. So the display is not actually flickering. Well, it is, but you can't see it with the naked eye. Okay. It's flickering about 5 times what it looks like on this. 5 or 10 times. 32 megahertz refresh rate. So that's higher than CB frequencies. But anyway, this is the old Voyager faceplate. And we're just waiting on the new faceplate that I had ordered, because I forgot about Echo. And just remember that RF gain is now here on this guy. Your SWR function is the same. That's not a band switch, that's your SWR switch. You don't need a band switch on this board. It's continuous tuning. And to make it jump one band at a time, you push that button there in, and every time you turn the channel selector, it changes 45 channels, either up or down. Helps you get from the top to the bottom really quick. All right, there's the chrome covers. See how well these things fit. Now, those screws that I put in there are zinc plated, with polished heads. Okay, they won't rust. That's why I buy those. Like I said, it fits really well. What fits even better than these are the stock 696 ELF covers. And I had a set of them. I was going to try to make them fit, but you can see they're pretty scratched up. But they fit really nice. Better than what these do, as a matter of fact. But there you are. Looking pretty good. And I've already showed you your fans, and when you press the amp button, this will say amp on the new one. You see your little indicator light come on there. When you turn that off, then of course the amplifier is off, the fans goes off, and the light goes out. All right, I'm not going to put the knobs on because I'm waiting on the decal. Once I get the decal put on there, then I'll put the knobs and the buttons on it and show you it complete. This is just an update. Okay, more to come. Okay, I wanted to show you how well this thing works with your microphone hooked up to it. Right now we're on, what are we on? We on AM? Nope, I'm on lower sideband with just the radio. Both of these meters have 100 watt slugs in them. One on the left is RMS, one on the right is peak. Audio, hello, hello, audio. Audio 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. Fan come on just then. Audio, hello, hello, audio, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now on that meter on the right, I've got it set on times 2. So you read on the top scale, we're hitting about 150 watts on that meter. The meter on the left is 100, and we're reading on the bottom scale on it. All right, let's see. A better shot of the RMS. Hello, audio, audio. Okay, let's get back over here and look at Pete. Audio, hello, hello, audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, audio test. It's hitting right around 150 watts, and that's with, you know, I'm not injecting a tone or anything, I'm just talking into the microphone. Hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, audio testing, testing audio. All right, and you were hearing it on my my Yaesu, and I got the RF gain turned all the way down. And we're going into the cantenna. There's the cantenna down there. And that was on lower sideband. Let me switch to AM. All right, we're dead keying about 20 watts on AM. Audio. Audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, test 1, 2. Okay. Of course, your fans are on and running. They'll stay on and run as long as the amp is turned on. And let's turn the amplifier off and do a check with the amp off on the AM. And I think I can put that back down on the times one scale. Hello, audio, audio, hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, audio. We're dead keying about 2 watts and swinging to about 10. Audio. Now I'll take that back. We're swinging to about 12. And then let's see what we're doing on peak. Audio. We're back reading that bottom scale there. We're doing about 30 watts peak. Audio on AM. But I turn that amplifier on. Audio, hello, hello, audio. Audio 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. I don't think I need to be on times 2 scale for AM, but I am. So we're now reading on the top scale. Audio, hello, hello, audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. About 125 watts on AM peak. Okay. She's a-humming. All right, I'll do another video once I get the new faceplate in hand, the new decal in hand, and put on here. But don't that look nice? Sure does. It's gonna look even better with a decal on it and this green display. Your meter, you notice, is green. Key to microphone, it turns red. Green and red. Okay. More to come. Okay, so what I did, I took the 5304 loose and I turned it around sideways and then remounted it. It looks like it might be interfering with that stuff back there, but it's not. The mounting bolt for the amp is touching it right there, but that's not going to hurt anything. Okay. And the speaker should fit now. So, I'll give it a shot. I'm back in this damn thing. When I went to set up your local distance switch for the RF gain, I'm just not getting enough signal. That's where the RF gain, which would be wide open, should be about 2.5 volts there. And I confirmed that on my test radio, which at that point right there, see, I got 2.69 volts on it. I should have that on this one. That's the same spot right there. I've only got 0.5 volt there, and that ain't right. Make sure, push that switch in, make sure I ain't got the switch wired up backwards. Nope, when I push the switch in, the voltage goes to zero. So there's shorty diode or something right there. I gotta figure out what the hell's going on with this. Well, I tell you what, this thing's had all kind of problems. It's a good thing you sent it in. See, there's my test radio right there. It's the Cobra 148 GTL. And I'm checking in the same place. This is a Uniden-made radio. And this one is a Ranger-made radio, but the PC board is basically the same. Yeah, see, with that switch pushed in, it goes to zero. With it out, 0.5 volt. All right. I'll be checking that. I need to power up my scopes. I need to do a compare between the in and the out. I need to set that one up for the spectrum analyzer. Anyway, more to come. Just thought you should know. Okay. I found the problem with the RF gain was D15. That little guy right there. D15 was open. So that's why the RF gain had no effect on the received signal. Okay, so now I got it set to where that when this button is out, your RF gain is all the way up, wide open, okay? Push that in, it knocks it down about halfway, about 4.5 dB. Okay, with it out, you got 9 dB. It's just, it reads a little bit high on the meter, and that's because of the receiver mod. Okay, now, if you want to adjust that differently, you pull off the top cover. See that adjustment right there with all the hot glue around it? That's your adjustment. And yes, I used hot glue to help stabilize that. It's two of the pins on the the variable resistor are soldered to the two pins on the switch. The third pin is floating. I wanted to make sure that it didn't move around, because if you run this in a mobile application, all these parts and stuff that are hanging off of things, including the wires, the vibration will cause them to break their solder connection, okay? So that's why I put the hot glue on the wires and also put the hot glue around the trimmer. You can adjust this trimmer for the amount of knockdown that you want, you know, when you press in the button, how much the local switch is going to knock down the signal. All right, that adjustment right there. You just take the top cover off and you can get to it from the top. Make sure you use a non-metallic adjustment, because you can see there's the thing underneath the bottom. Well, it's not that critical to use a non-metallic adjustment on this one. You can just use a regular old flat blade screwdriver. Just be real careful with it, because it will break fairly easily. Okay, but you can see when you punch that in now, you switch to local. It knocks down the incoming RF signal. It's like an attenuator, basically. A local DX switch. Alright, that's AM. You see, we're a little bit above 9. I'm not going to try to readjust it. I'm just going to leave it like that. There's lower sideband. AM. Okay. Alright, I'm going to put it back together. I was going to show you where D15 is. I forgot. There it is, right there. You see that? That's D15. Okay. And I turned on the amplifier when I flipped it over. All right, and remember, this fuse comes from inside this guy. Okay. The power cable comes in here, comes... Well, it actually goes to a couple of pads over here, and then comes around and comes out this guy that I've got inside this heat shrink bundle, and goes to your positive. Okay, the wires on the fuse holder were black. That's why it's black over here too. But it's positive, and that's just clear heat shrink that I put over that connection there. It's orange coming out of here. It's supposed to be red, but I don't know, whoever shipped me this wire is colorblind. But anyway, this fuse is a fuse going to this jack, okay? And from this jack down to the radio, you see the heavy-duty inductors I put in there. I've already showed you all that, okay? And here's how I turn the 5304 to make sure that we had plenty of room up here. You can see it's not interfering with anything back here. All right, so we've got plenty of room, and there you go. I gotta dress up these wires again, because I unhooked everything trying to figure out what the hell was wrong with the RF gain control. So, all right, I'll get it dressed up and put it back together. Okay, one more shot of the inside of it before I put the cover back on it. Yeah, I got the wires all dressed up. The two white wires there go to the speaker. Okay. All right, one other thing. All of your old parts and your new power cord is in this box, okay? Along with the instruction sheet for the RFX150, and your TRB-X3 is down in there also, okay? Here's your power cord. It ain't very long. So make sure that you use the same gauge wire when you extend it to the battery. Now this says 14 AWG on the side of it, but I would recommend going to 12 because of the length you're going to need to run to the battery. Okay? And all this will be in this box, and there's your old face. Okay? All right. Now let me show you the switches. Don S. in New Jersey, this is your final video. I know you're a truck driver, so I made sure to add hot glue to all the connections to make sure they don't come loose. Because you guys know that once you mount this radio right side up like this, the PC board bottom is at the top of the radio and all the components hang down. So up here in the front where all the wires are connected and where that adjustment is for your local DX switch, all of that has hot glue around it, okay? Because I know if you're a truck driver, this thing's going to be bouncing around. I used to drive a truck, so I know what you're going through, okay? Here's your microphone, okay? Wired into your new 4-pin connector. Just remember that in order for you to hear things coming out of the speaker, the microphone has to be plugged in, okay? We're using the microphone to switch transmit and receive because we changed from a 5-pin to a 4-pin, all right? And I did not put a relay inside the radio. You don't have room for a relay inside your radio. It's full. Okay. Let's do some modulation checks. Wanted to show you this. I've already showed you the output power. But here is the modulation on scope. Audio. Hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Audio test, test audio. Let me turn the readout down so it's not chopping it up. Maybe increase the time a little bit. See if that looks better. No, that's worse. Hang on a minute. Hello, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Audio. You can see your microphone will overdrive the radio. So just turn your mic gain down a little bit. Audio, hello, hello, audio. Turn it down to about audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. About 12 o'clock, looks pretty good. Okay, and that was on AM. Let's go to sideband. Audio, hello, hello, audio. Now on sideband, you're going to need to turn the mic gain back up. Audio, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Audio test, test audio, audio, 1, 2. Okay. As you can see, it looks pretty damn good. All right. Now then, back on AM. There's your 10-turn clarifier. I've already showed you how that works. Okay, this bottom switch on the right is your CSF switch. What that stands for is channel switch function. Okay, with this out, your channel switch changes channels one at a time. Push this in, your channel selector becomes a band switch. Okay, push that in. All right. See how it changes? It moves 45 channels at a time. Okay. Now, negative 15, that's your lowest channel right there. That is your highest channel. Okay. Just remember, if you do not have an amateur license, do not talk on 28 megahertz. All right. And let's see, what else do I want to show you? Your local DX switch. I think I showed you that already, but let's get back to it. Okay, right there, your local DX switch is out. Okay. Push that in, it knocks your receive down about halfway. It's like turning the RF gain knob down halfway, okay? That way we were able to use the RF gain knob for the mic gain because you wanted the echo and time put over here. I've already showed you how to do that, so I won't do that again. You know your noise blanker's working. I showed you that. And now let's do squelch scan. Okay. Before we get into squelch scan, let me show you something about these damn knobs. All right. The way these potentiometers are oriented in this radio, they're 180 degrees out of the way the knobs were made. Okay. Except for the SWR calibrate and the mic gain. The SWR calibrate and the mic gain, they're not 180 out, they're like 90 out, okay? That's all the way counterclockwise for the SWR calibrate, okay? That's my gain all the way down. See, you can see the lines. I hate this, but there ain't a damn thing I can do about it, okay? All right, there, you might gain is about halfway open. All the way around to there, my gain is wide open. You want to run it like that on sideband, and then run it about right there on AM, unless you really want to drive the crap out of it, then you can turn it up. It has about 120% modulation, okay, with it wide open. That's why you saw the flat topping on the waveform. All right. What else do I need to show you? I've already showed you the amp. When you turn the amp on, that light comes on, and of course your fans start running. Okay, and they will run until you turn the switch off. All right. Don, I sure hope you enjoy your radio. It was my pleasure to build it for you. 73s, everybody.